Welcome to the Getting Started with Marine Turtles in Mediterranean MPAs training course, organised by MedPAN in conjunction with the National Marine Park of Zakynthos. This module covers the biology of marine turtles with a focus on the species found in the Mediterranean. The module begins by introducing the seven species of turtle that exist today. It continues with a section on morphology to help the investigator name parts of a turtle and how to use these morphological characteristics to identify each species of turtle. Next, we will present a generalized marine turtle life cycle, highlighting the turtle's main habitats and ontogenetic life stages. And the module instruction ends with an overview of the migrations and distribution of the two species of turtle endemic to the Mediterranean. After the module, there will be a separate assessment to verify knowledge acquisition of the information presented here. There are seven species of marine turtle around the world, all living in warm temperate to tropical seas. Three of these species are common in the Mediterranean, with two of them forming endemic populations. Let's meet these three most common species. The loggerhead turtle is the most common turtle found in the Mediterranean and is a member of the more specious family of marine turtles, the chelonidae, or hard-shell turtles. This species is notable for its red-brown shell, creamy yellow underside, and relatively large head. It is a generalist feeder, eating shellfish, jellyfish, and fisheries discards, etc. It breeds extensively across the Mediterranean, having formed an endemic metapopulation, but immigrants from the Atlantic are common in the Western Mediterranean. The green turtle is the largest species of turtle breeding in the Mediterranean. It is also a member of the Chelonidae, or hard-shell turtles. The species is named not after the colour of its shell, but after the colour of its body fat, and this is the turtle that forms the traditional main ingredient of turtle soup. As large turtles and adults, green turtles are vegetarians, primarily feeding on seagrass and algae in shallow coastal waters. Some people argue it is the prettiest turtle we find in the Mediterranean, with its more patterned shell and smaller head in comparison to loggerheads, but this is a matter of subjective personal taste. The leatherback turtle completes the gang. It is the biggest and oddest of the marine turtle species. It may reach over 2 meters in total length and has a shell that is covered in black, rubbery skin. It is alone in the Demichelidae family and is the only non-hard-shelled species of marine turtle. This species, however, does not breed in the Mediterranean. It is an immigrant from Atlantic populations. It can be found across the Mediterranean, but it is most commonly found in the western part. These are the three species that represent nearly 100% of the turtles likely to be encountered in the Mediterranean, as the other species are either only rarely observed or never. But for completeness, we will show the others next. The first two species are the cogeneric Ridley turtles, and both species have recently been recorded in the Mediterranean. As adults, they are smaller than loggerheads, but loosely resemble them, with relatively large heads for their body size. However, they are much rounder than loggerheads when looking at them from above, and they lack the red-brown coloration. The Kemp's Ridley, shown on the left, nests almost exclusively in the Gulf of Mexico, so any appearing in the Mediterranean are way off course and would be, under natural circumstances, unable to return to where they are from, and therefore lost to the population. The Olive Ridley on the right nests in the Indian, Pacific, and Atlantic Oceans, with the nearest breeding populations in Western Africa. This species is very rarely seen in the Mediterranean. The last two species are the hawksbill on the left and the flatback on the right. The hawksbill turtle has a few historic records in the Mediterranean, having probably made the Lesepsian migration through the Suez Canal from the Red Sea, which holds the nearest breeding populations. These turtles have the most ornate shells and are the species traditionally exploited to construct becco or tortoiseshell items such as combs and glasses frames, etc. Lastly, the flatback turtle nests only in Australia and so will never ever be found in the Mediterranean. It's an odd hard-shell turtle, having a thin shell that can be scratched with a fingernail. Those are the seven species of turtle from around the world. Let us now look at turtle morphology, and especially at those body parts that can be used to identify the different species depending on their characteristic patterning. I gave some indication of how to tell apart the species of turtle in the Mediterranean through shell colour, relative size of the head to the body, or if the turtle has black rubbery skin, etc. But there are some definitive morphological characteristics that can be used, based on the number of scutes or scales on the turtle's body. Presented here is a typical scute arrangement, in this case for a loggerhead turtle. There may be some exceptions that often result in asymmetrical patterning, but this is the standard. The turtle's shell is known as a carapace. It has one nuchal scute at the front in the centre. It has five vertebral or central scutes that run down the midline of the carapace, with two supracaudal scutes forming the rear margin of the shell. Flanking either side of the vertebral scutes are pairs of costal or lateral scutes. There are either four pairs or five pairs of these scutes, depending on the species of turtle that we're looking at in the Mediterranean. The shell on the underside of a turtle is known as the plastron and comprises a paired row of scutes forming a central shield, and on either side of this central shield are inframarginal scutes. The number of inframarginal scutes on each side is also a diagnostic feature of a species. Looking at the head, we have paired prefrontal scales on the top of the head, behind the nostrils and between the eyes. And on the side of the head, behind each eye, are the postocular scales. The number of each of these is another diagnostic feature for species identification. As indicated, looking at the species of marine turtle in the Mediterranean, we can define them using scute and scale counts. Clearing the way to the endemic species, briefly we can mention the leatherback turtle, which does not have any of them, and instead has seven ridges running along its carapace that is covered in black rubbery skin. The species is quite unmistakable. Of the endemic species, let's start with the most ubiquitous, the loggerhead. Working rearwards, loggerhead turtles have two pairs of prefrontal scales, often with one or more interprefrontal scale between them, and they have three postocular scales on either side of the head. On the carapace, its frontmost costal scutes, of which there are five pairs, abut the nuchal scute, whilst on the underside there are three inframarginal scutes on either side of the plastron shield. Next is the green turtle. Working rearwards, green turtles have a single pair of prefrontal scales, and they have four postocular scales on either side of the head. On the carapace, its frontmost costal scutes, of which there are four pairs, do not abut the nuchal scute, whilst on the underside there are four inframarginal scutes on either side of the plastron shield. For completeness, and as they could get confused with juvenile loggerheads, here are the Ridley turtles. Their heads have the same scale pattern as loggerheads, with two pairs of prefrontal scales and three postocular scales on either side of the head. The carapace is much rounder than loggerheads, but the scute pattern is also similar. However, the olive Ridley generally has more than five costal scutes on either side of the carapace, with the pattern often not being symmetrical. The Ridley's undersides can be clearly differentiated from that of the loggerheads, as both species have four pairs of inframarginal scutes with paws, whereas the loggerhead has three pairs and lacks paws. Using these characteristics, together with the coloration and relative head-to-body size, it is possible to distinguish between all species of turtle present in the Mediterranean. A handy one-page marine turtle identification key, showing all but the flatback turtle, is supplied with this course as an aid to identifying individuals in the field. Now you will know how to identify your turtle species. It is important to understand their life cycle and consequently the reasoning behind why the turtles are where they are, and the relative worth in terms of conservation value depending on the turtle's size class. This section has been adapted from the SWOT website with the source URL presented here. Starting at A, here we have an adult female turtle on a nesting beach. The marine turtle nesting season in the Mediterranean runs from late May to August, with a peak in June and July. Females come ashore to lay eggs within a few weeks of mating. After making their way up the beach to reach warmer sand, they use their front flippers to dig a large depression called a body pit. Females then use their back flippers to dig a smaller hole in the rear end of the body pit, called an egg chamber, into which they deposit around 100 soft-shelled eggs. After refilling the hole and covering their nest with sand, a process known as camouflaging the nest, they return to the sea. Marine turtles do not display any form of parental care other than that of creating a suitable nest in which to deposit their eggs. Turtle sex is not genetically defined as it is with mammals, but is determined primarily by the temperature the egg experiences during the middle third of its incubation. There's a pivotal temperature, somewhere around 29.5 degrees Celsius, that produces equal ratio of male and female hatchlings. There is a small range of temperatures around this where both sexes of turtle are produced, and then warmer conditions produce females and colder ones males. B. Adult females return to feeding areas after the nesting season. Females must return to feeding areas, generally nearshore neritic areas, after each nesting season to replenish their energy stores for the next reproductive season. This down period, when they don't breed, typically takes more than a year and generally lasts 2 to 3 years or more. Both adults, females and males, and large juveniles are present to feed in these areas. C. Hatchlings move to open water and spend their early years in oceanic habitat. When fully developed, embryos break through the eggshell and the hatchlings slowly dig their way to the surface, typically en masse. This process can take several days. Hatching season in the Mediterranean is generally from mid-July to October. Hatchlings generally wait under the sand until night to head to the sea, when they can use the cover of darkness to avoid detection by the many predators on the beach and in the water. After reaching the water, hatchlings enter into a multi-day swimming frenzy, during which they swim almost continuously, fueled only by leftover yolk which they have absorbed into their body. This frenzy helps them reach deeper water away from the shore where there are less predators. The little turtles are then transported by strong currents to open water oceanic habitats, where they live in flotsam and have an omnivorous diet. This oceanic stage can last from a few years to decades and is known as the lost years, as little is known about the turtles at this time. D. Developmental migrations to neritic feeding areas. After this oceanic period, the juvenile turtles move into highly productive neritic nearshore feeding areas to finish growing, a process that can also take as little as a few years or as long as a few decades. These foraging grounds tend to offer a greater abundance of variety of food than the open ocean. Subadult and adult turtles also occupy these neritic feeding areas, adult turtles remaining these areas until they have accumulated sufficient energy reserves to migrate to breeding areas for reproduction. E. Adult migration to natal beaches for mating. After acquiring sufficient body resources, adult female and male turtles migrate to breeding areas to mate and, in the case of females, to nest. Males migrate more frequently than females, as their biological investment in breeding is less demanding. The distance between feeding and breeding areas in the Mediterranean can be from 100 to 2,000 kilometers. Each breeding season, females generally return to nest at the same beach or group of beaches from which they themselves emerge as hatchlings. The return migration by an adult turtle to the beach of its birth is called natal homing. F. Mating in coastal areas near nesting beaches. Although a female only needs to mate with one male to obtain enough sperm to fertilize all of her eggs in a season, mating with more than one male, resulting in multiple paternity, is common in marine turtles. Females are only receptive to males before they begin nesting for that season. After this time, they reject the male's approaches. Males can be quite aggressive during the mating season, both with other males and with females. G. Adult males return to feeding areas. Like females, male turtles show natal homing, but visit broader areas and more sites than females do. Males will try to mate with as many females as they can during a single breeding season. Once males are no longer finding receptive mates, which is very early in the nesting season, they return to their feeding areas. H. Into nesting habitats. Females remain near their nesting beaches during a nesting season that can last 1 to 2 months. Depending on the species, female turtles lay between 2 and 5 clutches of eggs in a season, one clutch deposited every 12 to 16 days. After completion of egg laying, we return to B and females depart the breeding area to return to their feeding area. Adult female turtles in the Mediterranean have been recorded breeding for over 30 years, during which time they will have laid several thousands of eggs, from which only a very small percentage of hatchling turtles will survive to adulthood. It is clear, therefore, that conservation of large juvenile and adult turtles is relatively more beneficial to a population than protecting the same number of eggs or hatchlings or small juveniles. We've now covered what turtle species there are breeding in the Mediterranean and their typical life cycle, indicating that they are tied to specific beach areas to breed and neritic areas to feed. Over the next few minutes, we will look at several distribution maps for loggerheads and greens to determine where are their critical habitats. This busy map from a recent SWOT report shows all aspects of the distribution of loggerhead and green turtles in the Mediterranean. Starting with the location of the nesting beaches, which are presented as dots or circles on the maps, we can see that loggerhead nesting, the blue circles, is concentrated in the eastern Mediterranean, in Greece, Turkey and Cyprus, with notable nesting in Libya and lesser nesting sites in Tunisia, Israel, Lebanon, Syria and Egypt. In recent years, regular nesting has started occurring along the southern shores of Italy, and regular but sparse nesting has started in Spain, probably as a result of climate change and a warming Mediterranean environment. Green turtle nesting, shown as green circles, is largely restricted to eastern Turkey, Cyprus and Syria, with smaller nesting populations in Lebanon, Israel and Egypt. Greece and Tunisia have both recorded single green turtle nesting events in recent years, which may indicate the early onset of range expansion for this species, similar to that of the loggerhead. Satellite tracking of loggerheads from juvenile to adult stages shows that the central Mediterranean and the southern part of the western Mediterranean has important pelagic open sea habitats for this species, which are shown as darker coloured hexagons on the map, whereas tracking of mainly adult female green turtles shows a more limited coastal distribution with directed open sea migratory routes. Let's now take a closer look at these migratory routes of adult females, which are the best studied segment of the population in terms of animals tracked. Here we have the migratory paths of post-nesting adult female turtles. The nesting locations are depicted with stars and are the origins of the tracks. This map for loggerheads shows that they use a lot of open sea in the eastern Mediterranean to get from their nesting site to chosen feeding area, shown as paler migratory funnels, or they pass along coastal tracks acting as migratory corridors to get to their final destinations, shown as darker lines. And these destinations are most commonly shallow coastal areas. Whilst green turtles in this overlay are shown to less extensively use open sea migratory funnels and display more extensive movements along coastlines. At the end of their migrations, they exclusively reside in shallow nearshore waters where their seagrass and algal food grows in abundance. These maps will need to evolve as new data comes in from other important nesting areas. This is especially true for loggerhead turtles, as the map currently does not depict any migrations from Turkish nesting areas and lacks tracks from Kyparissia Bay in Greece, which hosts the largest nesting aggregation in the Mediterranean. The areas and locations indicated here are neritic foraging destinations, meaning feeding areas in waters less than 200 meters deep. They are for all life stages of turtle, which is why we now have a foraging area shown in the western Mediterranean. Green turtle foraging sites are very localized in shallow coastal zones, as they tend to have restricted home ranges for feeding, and these are presented as green arrows, whereas the more widespread omnivorous loggerheads occupy larger areas of often deeper water as they roam the region looking for food. From tracking, it is clear that the northern Adriatic Sea and the Shelf Sea off the eastern coast of Tunisia are the most important areas for loggerhead turtles, and these were the two main areas that had previously been identified through recovery of flipper tags originating on turtles that had nested on Greek beaches. To recap this introduction to the biology and ecology of marine turtles, we have learned that two of the seven species of marine turtle breed in the Mediterranean and have endemic populations. These are the more numerous loggerhead and the green turtle. We can identify turtle species using scute and scale patterns. For example, loggerheads have five costal scutes on either side of their carapaces, and green turtles have four. Marine turtles are long-lived and slow to mature, with reproductive lifespans that may last multiple decades. Their main regular breeding sites are in the eastern Mediterranean, with green turtles even more restricted to the northeastern part of the eastern Mediterranean. Young turtles disperse widely across the Mediterranean in the open sea for the first few years of life, and then, when they have grown large enough to control their buoyancy, they shift to shallower, more coastal locations. Turtles are able to return to breed at or near the same location they were born, and this is called natal homing. And lastly, loggerhead turtles remain omnivorous feeders throughout their lives, whereas green turtles switch to herbivory as they shift into shallow coastal waters. That ends the instruction part of the module. An interactive task and a fill-in-the-blanks worksheet have been created to verify you have learned the key facts presented here, and these are fundamental background knowledge for all conservation and management applications. Thank you. You have now completed the presentation for Module 1 of the Getting Started with Marine Turtles in the Mediterranean MPAs course, organized by MedPAN in conjunction with the National Marine Park of Zakynthos.